For deformations due to pure bending that are within the elastic region, we see that the strain increases linearly from zero at the neutral axis. We'll later study how plastic deformation for bending originates at the planes farthest from the neutral axis, causing portions of the volume to be undergoing plastic deformation while the core is still within the elastic range, but for purely elastic deformation, this linear increase in strain is an accurate assumption. By looking at a composite bar made out of material 1 and material 2, top and bottom, where the elastic modulus of 1 is lower than that of 2, we'd see that the strain starts at 0 for y equal to 0, that is, on the neutral axis, and it increases linearly until it reaches a maximum value either at the top or the bottom. There is no discontinuity of the strain at the boundary between material 1 and 2. If there was a discontinuity, and the value of the strain was different between even 1 nanometer into material 2 and 1 nanometer into material 1, we would effectively have the surface at the boundary slipping with respect to each other, and therefore we'd have the material literally breaking apart at the boundary. By multiplying the strain by the elastic modulus of the material, we see that there is indeed a discontinuity of the stress at the boundary, which is totally fine. Because the elastic modulus of material 2 is higher than that of material 1, material 2 can take a higher stress coming from the bending moment and still result in a comparable strain to material 1. So it is expected to see a discontinuity between materials at the boundary for values of stress. This discontinuity could just as well occur if the cross-section of the bar was not rectangular, but somewhat T-shaped. The strain would still not show any discontinuity, as again, we don't expect the material to crack and slip at the Y value for which the width of the cross-section changes. The top part cannot be deforming more than the lower part, otherwise that would happen. But the stress that we would calculate from My over I with the larger area would be higher if we suddenly reduce the value of I to make it a rectangular bar. There are many reasons why the resulting transformed section should only transform its base and not its height, or more accurately put, for general purposes, why the transformation affects the dimension that is perpendicular to the axis of the bending. I'll mention three of them here, but each one of them is enough on its own to justify the statement. If we were transforming the height h to compensate for the different elastic modulus, we would be effectively modifying the location of the neutral axis, which throws off all remaining calculations as all of them rely on the neutral axis location. More importantly, if the neutral axis is moved because of our modifications to the model, it would no longer be representative of what is actually happening with the original cross-section. With a transformed height, we would find either a higher value for the maximum strain, as we now go higher or lower to reach the top or bottom surface of the bar, or we would have to change the slope to get to the previously maximum strain value, which would either mess up the maximum strain at the other end, in this case at the bottom, or just completely change the neutral axis once again to maintain both original values. And again, neither of these would be representative of the actual strain profile that describes the strain within the materials. One more reason, sufficient on its own as well, but more mathematical and therefore serving as more of a proof, is that the infinitesimal force DF that we studied during the main pure bending stress video, link below to that specific part of the video if you need a refresher, is obtained by multiplying the stress times the area dA. The stress is the elastic modulus times the strain, and the strain was derived to be minus y over rho. Since changing the height causes the neutral axis to move, the value of y would either increase or decrease, changing the value of the infinitesimal force dF, which again contradicts what we had previously proved. From this expression, we easily see that the elastic modulus of one material can be written as n times the elastic modulus of a second material, where n is just a ratio between elastic moduli. Moving the n ratio next to dA, we see that what our transform section is really doing is making our infinitesimal area slightly wider. And this is why, to use the transform sections, we make the cross-section of the material we're trying to replace wider or skinnier, not taller or shorter. The first step to use transformed sections to calculate stresses, or even beam deflections, in members made of two or more materials, commonly known here as composite materials, is to calculate the ratio between elastic moduli. If the current strain in material 1 has to be equal to the new strain, when we transform it into material 2, and strain is the stress over the elastic modulus, And at the same time we know that the stress is the sum of all the forces over the sum of areas, we see that the dFs should not be changing before and after the transformation, and this means that the new area should be an E1 over E2 ratio times the original area. Following what we just stated about the height having to remain the same, the conclusion here is that the new width is the E1 over E2 ratio times the original width, or W1. This applies to whatever material you want to transform, as long as you call material 1 the material that's going to be transformed. After transforming the section of material 1 into a wider or thinner section of material 2, we can perform our usual steps to calculating the bending stress. We find the neutral axis by finding the overall centroid of the cross-section with what we referred to as the weighted average for centroids, linked to a 10-minute centroids-focused video below if you need a quick review. And with the neutral axis, we can find the distance to the top or the bottom of the member to find the Y value needed to calculate the highest tensile or compressive stresses. With the neutral axis, we can also calculate the second moment of area I. With the second moment of area of each shape that makes up the entire cross-section and the distance from the neutral axis to the centroid of each shape, we can use the parallel axis theorem to calculate the overall I for the bending stress equation. A link to a parallel axis theorem 3-minute video excerpt is down in the description of this video. The moment M in the My over I equation is found completely separately from the transformed section process and can be found by performing a shear and bending moment diagram. A link to that review is also in this video's description. Once we have all of these values, substituting them for both Y values, the top and the bottom, would result in the stresses found at the top and the bottom for material 2. If the top or the bottom is in fact made originally from material 2, the stress expression is accurate and there's no need for further calculations. On the other hand, if the top or the bottom was originally made of material 1, like it is the case for the top in this example, then we need to transform the stress back to a material 1 type of stress. Using the same starting point we used before, where the strains should remain the same before and after the transformation, we see that the stress in material 1 is equal to the stress in the new transformed material times the elastic moduli ratio, the exact same one we used before, not the reciprocal. The actual stress at the top where the material was originally material 1 would be equal to the elastic modulus ratio times what we previously calculated, which means that to go back to the actual stress of the original material, we multiply the stress in the new material times n. Let's put what we've learned today into practice with a simple, short example, and if you'd like to watch more complex problems being solved, make sure to watch the additional example videos linked in this video's description. A copper strip and an aluminum strip are bonded together to form the composite beam shown. Knowing that the beam is subjected to a 35 Newton meter couple, what is the maximum stress in the aluminum and the copper? Remember to try this on your own before watching this solution. Following the steps that we mentioned in this video, we will begin by calculating the ratio between the elastic moduli. We can transform the aluminum to be thinner or the copper to be thicker. Let's transform the copper into aluminum, which means that the elastic modulus ratio n would be 1.4. The transformed section would be all aluminum, with the bottom half being 1.4 times the 24 millimeters. The neutral axis can be calculated by calculating the centroid of this new cross-section by adding the AY bars together and dividing by the total area. The Y bar values would be the distance from our datum or point of reference to the centroids of the two shapes that make up our cross-section. With the location of the neutral axis from our datum, we now know the distance from the neutral axis to the top and to the bottom. With it, we can also use the parallel axis theorem to calculate the second moment of area. The distance from the neutral axis to the centroid of area 1 would be 3.5 millimeters, and the distance from the neutral axis to the centroid of figure 2 would be 2.5 millimeters. With the second moment of area for rectangles and their areas, we find the second moment of area for the transformed section. With the moment, Y, and I, we can directly substitute the values to find the maximum stress in the aluminum, since our transformed section is made of aluminum only. On the other hand, for the copper, the value from the expression minus My over I would be the value for the stress if the material at the bottom, 5.5 millimeters below the neutral axis, was aluminum, But since it's copper, we find the actual stress in the copper if we multiply that expression by the elastic modulus ratio n. For a positive moment, it makes sense that the top surface is under compression and the bottom surface is under tension. And since the copper has a higher resistance to deformation, it makes sense that the magnitude of the stress is higher in the copper. Of course, this is only true because the two sheets of metal were equally thick. This would not be as clear for any other type of cross-section composite material. For more examples on bending stress in composite materials, as well as the other topics of the Mechanics of Materials course videos, make sure to check out the links in the description below. Thanks for watching!